We are in a series right now called Journey. And in this series, we've talked about the fact that every one of us in life are on a journey of some kind. We're all headed somewhere. We're all going through moments and seasons that sometimes can create a little bit of chaos. Sometimes we don't understand. And in this series, I've got a prayer for you, and I've said it every week, and I'm going to continue to say it. My prayer for you, every one of you, young and old, guest, or you've been here a long time, my prayer for you is simply this, that number one, you would gain insight. My prayer is that learning about these other stories, that you would gain insight maybe to why your story looks like this. My other prayer is that you would gain encouragement. I know that sometimes when we're on the journey, we get tired, right? Sometimes when we've been on the road or we've been in a race or we're just going through life, it can be tiring. How many parents would say raising children can be tiring? The parents that did not raise their hands are heavily medicated. Okay? How many of you can say that being married can be tiring sometimes? Husbands and wives, come on, don't lie. Don't be lying in church. Life can be exhausting. Life can be challenging. There's ups, there's downs. And my prayer for you is that through those ups and downs that you would gain insight and that you would receive encouragement. I don't think today's going to be any different as well. This week, we're going to be talking about a guy named Job. The last 2 weeks, and I encourage you to check those out online at firstassembly.tv. We talked about Joseph. This week, we're going to talk about a guy named Job. And I know there's some of you in this room that maybe you don't know who Job is. So let me give you a little bit of a backstory. See, the book of Job is in the Old Testament. And it is the oldest book in the Bible. Now, most people think, no, Pastor, Genesis is the oldest. It's in there first. Well, it's not. Job is actually the oldest book of the Bible. Some people tend to wonder, maybe it's just a story. It didn't really happen. I believe it happened. I believe it was put there for a reason, and I believe it's to help us through our journey as well. Job was an interesting man. In chapter 1, the Bible says that Job was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. Now, this is the kind of guy that everybody wants to be friends with. This is the kind of guy you want to put on your board or maybe even in the pulpit. I mean, this guy had it going on. This is the man of manly men. Did y'all catch that? All right. Let me explain a little bit more about his life. He was the kind of guy that everybody looked to as being upright, integrity, character. He feared the Lord. He was blameless. He didn't break the law or the commandments. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. We know that he was a family man. 7 sons, 3 daughters, and he probably had gray hair with that many kids. He had 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camel, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 female donkeys. We also know that he had a multitude of servants. You had to take care of that many animals, right? So this guy, not only was he upright and blameless, not only was he a man of integrity and character, but we know that he was a man that had wealth. He had value, if you will. And the Bible says that at the time that this story took place, that he had the greatest wealth in all of the East. That says a lot. So we're not just talking about an obscure man. We're talking about a man who is in the spotlight that people know, that people serve, that people have had business dealings with. He had everything going for him. But then, then the journey changes. Let me give you some insight. I don't have time to give you the entire story of Job, so I'm going to give you some highlights. I want to give you some insights from this guy's life. If you have your Bibles, we're in Job chapter 1, verse 7. And it says, "The Lord said to Satan," so we have a conversation happening between God and Satan, "From where have you come?" Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro the earth and from walking up and down on it." And the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on all the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "Does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and his house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Behold, all that he has is in your hand. Only against him do not stretch your hand." So Satan went out of the presence of the Lord. Let me stop right there. I want to give you some insight. Now, here we see a conversation between God and Satan. If you didn't catch it in all the words there, that God goes, "Hey, have you seen my boy Joe, man? He's awesome." And Satan's like, "Well, because you bless him. That's why he's so great." And God goes, "Absolutely not. He's great because he loves me." So he says, "Fine, you can go mess with him, Satan." And this the story begins. But I want you to see something very important that affects your journey. And that's this. The natural and the supernatural work in tandem. The natural and the supernatural work in tandem. Now let me just put a pause there. Because I know what that means for some people. You know who they are. You've seen them in your life before. Those weird people that are like demon chasers. And they're like, "Oh, there's a devil in the water. There's stuff floating, you know. Oh, my goodness, I broke my toe. It was the devil." Oh, you know, and they're constantly looking for these things. And they're consumed by that. But let me tell you this. Without being weird about it, and y'all know what I mean, there is a spiritual side to everything. When you can't see it, you can't smell it, you can't touch it, but behind every circumstance, behind every situation, behind everything that is happening in your journey, there is something spiritual taking place because the natural and the supernatural work in tandem. Do you have that? Now, I know that for some of you, you think, "Well, no, that's just life." Well, friends, I don't mean to scare you or upset you, but even in this room, even in this moment, there is spiritual warfare that is taking place in the heavenlies that you can't see. There are things that you are being tempted with. There are distractions that are happening in your mind. Some of you have already felt those distractions this morning. Maybe it was during worship. "I don't feel like I'm good enough to worship God. I can't surrender to God because I'm not good enough. I don't want to worship because I'm tired. I don't want to do this. My legs hurt. I'm going to just sit down and I don't care what's happening. And I'm just going to turn my mind off and think on other things." There's something spiritual happening at all times. Amen? So we know that they work in tandem, and we know that in this moment that Job was set up to be tested. And I want to make sure that we understand that in case you weren't here the past few weeks. When we say being tested, we're not talking about the fact that like a teacher tests a student, how good are you going to do? Are you going to pass or are you going to fail? No, it's more like someone who works with metal. He's being refined. The word testing in the Bible is a form of refinement. Job is being set up for an opportunity to deal with some mess. And every one of us in this room have some mess that need to be dealt with. Let's continue the story in verse 13. "Now there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And there came a messenger to Job and said, 'The oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding beside them. And the Sabaeans fell upon them and took them and struck down the servants with the edge of the sword. And I alone have escaped to tell you.' While he was yet speaking, there came another and said, 'The fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them. And I alone have escaped to tell you.' And while he was yet speaking, there came another and said, 'The Chaldeans formed three groups and made a raid on the camels and took them and struck them down, the servants with the edge of the sword. And I alone have escaped to tell you.' And while he was yet speaking, there came yet another and said, 'Your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house.'" And we'll get to them in a minute. In this moment, Job lost his livelihood. All those great animals, all that stuff that he had stockpiled, in a moment, his livelihood was gone. I think there's some of you in this room that have felt that have stored up retirement only to see it washing away. There's people in this room that you've worked hard for a job only to see it crumble before you. In this season of testing, he lost his livelihood. Look at verse 19. "And behold, a great wind came across the wilderness and struck the four corners of the house, and it fell upon the young people, and they are dead, and I alone have escaped to tell you." His home got destroyed. So first, everything gets raided. They come in one by one and say, "You've lost your livelihood." Then they come in and say, "The four pillars of your house have been blown out. The house has collapsed. You've lost your sense of security." A home always symbolizes security. And not only that, but you've also lost all your children that were inside of that home. So he's lost his livelihood, he's lost his security, and now he's lost his heritage. Let me tell you something. When you're in a season of testing, the enemy will always target your future. The enemy always targets our future. Our livelihood, what the future may look like, our security, our those things that we've put around us to make us feel safe moving forward, our heritage. The enemy always tries to attack our future. Yet, in Job chapter 1, verse 21. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. All right, let me stop right there, because this is usually where people stop reading Job. This is the moment they go, well, what kind of guy loses everything and just goes, well, blessed be the Lord? How many of you would respond that way? Don't respond. Don't answer. But you wouldn't. You wouldn't go through a season of losing your future, your livelihood, your security, your heritage, and go, well, bless the Lord, oh my soul. I mean, great song. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. I wonder, was he talking to himself going, boy, you better get yourself under control? I don't know. As if losing his livelihood, security, and heritage wasn't enough, he lost something else. Look at it in verse chapter 2, verse 7. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with loathsome sores from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. And he took a piece of broken pottery to which he scraped himself as he sat in ashes. You know, what I have found is that oftentimes when it comes to our future, it can be discouraging. When it comes to our future being attacked, it can knock the wind out of us. But there's something inside of us that is able to rise up. Well, I can recoup my money. I can get a loan from the bank if I need to. I can do this. I can do that. I can make it happen. It's all good. So the enemy turns it up and then attacks his health. As if losing his livelihood and security wasn't enough. Now he's covered in boils and feeling pain. But just like the enemy was attacking one overall area before, the enemy's doing it again. Whereas before the enemy was trying to destroy Job's future, now the enemy targets his present, just like he does yours. The enemy targets our present. It's one thing to look at our future and go, no, I'll recover from that. It'll work out. I know that it feels like everything's falling apart now, but no, it'll work out. I'll make it up. We'll get through this. But then when the present is attacked, we don't know how to respond. And I think there's some of you here today that you feel like your present is being attacked. I think there's some of you in this room that have gotten doctor reports that you just don't seem right or fair, and it doesn't make sense. That there's something happening in your life today, in your marriage today, in your family today, and you're going, this isn't fair. And the enemy's targeting our present. It's this constant reminder. So Job's in a bad place. So what happens when we get into a bad place? Well, oftentimes we have friends that show up. So three of his friends come and visit Job, and they sit together and mourn. The Bible says that for 7 days they sat and mourned. Now, in the Bible times, what that meant, I know this may sound weird, but in biblical times, mourning meant that they would sit in ashes, they'd cover themselves in ashes. Oftentimes, they would wear burlap that was really uncomfortable, and they would just sit there and just mourn, just cry and weep and sulk and everything else. Nowadays, we escape through hobbies, we go to a bar, we do something to escape from it. But not in this story. See, for 7 days, he sat there in those ashes. What do you think he was doing for 7 days?
Not fair.
Right? Isn't that what you would do? Y'all are so spiritual. Man, I got the most spiritual church, dude. They don't go through stuff. But when I go through stuff, I do just like you do. This isn't fair, God. You took my loved one. I know it's far, but it hurts. It's not fair. I'm mourning. I'm going through something. You've allowed this to happen to my finances, and it's not fair. I'm upset about it. This relationship's being affected. I'm just, it's good preaching right there. So what happens? Look at Job 3:1. This is such an important verse because this is so us. It says, and after this, after the 7 days of mourning, Job opened his mouth and cursed the day of his birth. That's good right there. After 7 days of whining and complaining and sulking and mourning and hurting for good reason, his response is, I'm going to complain about the day of my birth. Let me tell you something that I think you need to get a hold of today. When the enemy attacks our present and our future, we typically turn and attack our past. That's really heavy, and I need to unpack that. When the enemy is attacking our present and even our future, your natural response and my natural response is to attack our past. Well, it's my fault. I shouldn't have done this. I wish I had never been born. This is just, I should never have married that man. I should never have gotten that job. I should have, would have, could have, not. Right? And we turn to attack our past. And in Job's case, he spent the next chapter, 26 verses of scripture. Job questions his past, his existence, and listen to this, his value. And we do it too when we're going through a season, a part of our journey, when it seems like everything's falling apart. We don't see what God's doing. We don't understand the big picture. We begin to look to the past and question our value. Does God not love me? Am I not good enough? Am I not his child? Am I not a son or a daughter? Am I not all these things the Bible says? Is God upset with me? We tend to turn and attack our past. See, the enemy doesn't have to attack our past. We do it pretty good on our own. We don't need the enemy to remind us of our past because we're pretty good at it. Everything's falling apart. It was probably because of this and this, and I shouldn't have done that. And you may be right in some of that, but not attacking your value. See, it's all right to look to our past and to evaluate. But when our past destroys our current value, there's a problem. See, something unique happens when we look at our past to make sense of the present. I don't know why, but we tend to justify thinking to make sense of the nonsense. Truth is, you can't make sense of it. Life doesn't always make sense. If you're a young person here and your parents have failed to tell you this, let your pastor tell you. Life ain't fair. Amen. Okay? It's part of the journey. Especially when we can't see the big picture. So what do? We try to make sense of it. There's a question that I think that every one of us tend to ask when we're going through a journey similar to Job's, where our future has been attacked and our present has been attacked and now we're attacking our past. I think there's something that we naturally tend to do. See, I think that we tend to ask the question, why? I've already alluded to it a good bit this morning, but why, God? How many of you have ever asked the question, why, God? Don't lie. I got my hand up first. I beat you to it. Okay, for those of you that didn't raise your hand, you have asked it, you just don't admit to it in case it's a trick question. Why, God? Why does this happen? Well, Job's three friends came to help answer the question why. He had three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. They tried to come help answer the question why. Eliphaz affirms Job's lamenting that life isn't fair. So his first friend comes in and goes, you're right, life's not fair. Let's just complain more about it. Let's just sit here for seven more days. It's just not fair. Remember, this is a guy that was upright, that was blameless, that feared God, that was righteous in so many ways. So then his next friend, Bildad, assumes, well, Job, it's probably something you've done wrong, son. You ever had one of those friends? That they come to comfort you and they're going, well, you probably deserved it. Bad things happen to good people because good people ain't good. That's probably what happened. You're a bad person and you're not admitting to it. And he starts drilling Job, well, maybe you are a sinner and you just act like a good person. Zophar tries to comfort him with this. Well, it could be worse. At least he's positive. Maybe you've had one of those friends. You're going through a season where things are falling apart, and here's this person in your life going, well, heck, it could be worse. I just lost 10 children, all my livelihood, my security, my heritage, my health, and you're going to tell me it could be worse? That's a positive friend, but it's still not what Job needed. Job responds to each of his friends by describing his integrity and his righteousness. In each one of these circumstances, Job is going, no, that can't be it. I'm righteous. I have integrity. I'm above reproach. It can't be me. And then this guy named Elihu speaks up. Wasn't one of Job's friends. He was a friend of a friend. He was a young boy that happened to be traveling along being mentored. And he finally speaks up because he's tired of hearing all the arguing. And Elihu speaks up in chapter 32, and for the next six chapters, he's ripping Job and all his friends apart. It's a great story if you haven't read it. For six chapters, this young boy is telling these older men how off base they are and how much Job needs to open his eyes and recognize that something is going on. And to be honest, he's got most of it right. He alludes to the fact that there's a heart issue of some kind. Not necessarily sin, but a heart issue. And of course, Job doesn't see it because he's still asking the wrong question. He's still asking the question, why? So God finally speaks up. He's heard enough. And God speaks up by first shutting up all the other people. I love God. God steps onto the scene. He's tired of hearing all the bickering and all the trying to justify things. And God speaks up. Look at it in chapter 38, verse 1. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind, which is pretty cool, let's be honest. The Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? He's got these men in his life that are speaking into his life. And this isn't in your notes, but I need you to listen to me. When you're on a journey, a God-given journey, the worst thing you can have is the wrong voice speaking into your life. Okay? I hear it. I see it all the time. Facebook's the worst. For some reason, people feel that Facebook is the perfect place to share their deepest hurts and sorrows. It's a maturity issue. But as soon as they do, you'll notice all the comments. And you're looking at the comments going, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. That's bad advice. You better not listen to that. I don't give Facebook advice. We'll talk on the phone or some other way. The worst thing you can do when you're on the journey is to have the wrong voice. So God shows up and he silences the wrong voices. And then in verse 3, look what he says. It says, dress for action like a man. I will question you, and you make it known to me. Let me put it in Pastor Jeremy's vernacular. This is Pastor Jeremy's interpretation. Man up, boy. I'm about to ask you some questions, and you're going to answer them. He's a good daddy, isn't he? Sometimes that's what a dad needs to say. Boy, you need to man up, because we're about to have a hard conversation, you and me. And for these next few chapters, God responds to Job's question of why with his own questions. 77 questions God asks Job without giving Job an opportunity to respond. See, whereas we tend to ask why, God tends to ask the question who. In the midst of the journey, God's not interested in responding to your why. At any point, God in his omnipotent power could have said, well, Job, let me tell you what's up. Me and this guy named Satan, we've been having a talk. You can't see him. It's a supernatural thing. But let me tell you what's going on. You're being tested, so man up and deal with it. At any time, God could have answered that. But he chose not to answer Job's why questions. He chose to ask who questions. Questions like, do you know who I am? 77 questions get asked to Job. Most of them have to do with, Job, do you know who I am? Were you there when I created the universe? Were you there when I created the dinosaurs? Were you there when I caused the sun to shine and the waves to move? Were you there when I created man? Do you know who I am, Job? Do you know who I am as the omnipotent creator, the lover of you, your creator? Do you know me? And then he asks these questions, do you know who you are? He continued to ask Job questions like, who are you? Where were you? He's digging in deep to Job's heart in the midst of this journey after he shut up all of the poor advice. He's asking two very pointed questions. Do you know who I am? And do you know who you are? And I'd be honest with you, most of you in this room from this side to this side, from here to there, would answer that question, yes, I know who God is. And yes, I know who I am. Remember, Job is a man upright. Righteous, without blame, fears God. But yet here's God asking, do you even know who I am? Do you know who you are? He's trying to get Job to look beyond himself and see God and to see himself beyond his prideful perception. See, when you read just parts of Job, you see an unfair life. But when you stop and read all of Job together, you see that there is a common thing throughout all of it. Job had a heart issue. It was pride. And I know that there's people in this room, I'm going to get real personal with you. If you're a guest and think, man, that preacher's mean, come back next week. It'll be a little bit softer. But I'm going to shoot you straight today. I believe there's people in this room that would say, I'm like Job. I'm a good person. In fact, why don't you just turn to your neighbor, look them in the eyes if you know them, and say, you're a good person. Everybody get somebody? You're a good person. For those of you that are insecure because somebody didn't say it to you and you wish they had, it's okay. You're a good person. You're a good person. Many of you in this room, you've been in church for longer than this church building even existed. There's people here that were here during the time this building was built. There's people that have been involved in this church for ages. There's people in this room that are new. There's people in this room. Today is your first day being here. We are excited you came to be here today. But regardless of where you're at on the journey, regardless of the fact that you might be a great man or a woman of integrity, that you might even be righteous, despite all of that, there's something real that needs to happen in our heart. In leadership books, there's a common saying, good is the number one enemy to great. And I believe that's true. That's great. But see, there's something more to that statement, because just like Job, many of us in this room, you can come back, have settled for good. Come on, listen to me. There's many of you in this room. You have settled for good, and some of you have even settled for great, that things are going awesome, that life is everything I could ever imagine. This is awesome. You've settled for greatness. Look at Job, man. He was the epitome of greatness. We've settled. I think there's more to the statement, because when we settle for good or even great, we've missed the fact that we're meant to reflect our God, who is beyond good and who is beyond great. And I think that there's many of us in this room that we've settled. See, in the beginning, I told you that I was going to guarantee you that today you would hear from God. Here in just a moment, you're going to, and I'm going to ask everybody, please don't put your bulletins up. Please. Pretty please. I'm going to ask you for just a moment to close your eyes. And I want you to hear my voice. It doesn't matter how you would describe yourself as being good or great, righteous, upright, above reproach, having it all together. I put a question in your notes, and you're going to have a moment to answer it in just a moment. But I want you to hear the voice of the Lord speak to you. Because see, my prayer this week has been very specific. That when I ask this question, you don't even have to read it. I'm going to ask it. That the Lord would speak to your heart and that He would challenge you. The question is this. What is the one thing that God might be trying to root out of your life in the midst of your current journey? What is the one thing that the Lord might be trying to root out of your life during this current journey? For Job, it was pride. For Job, he thought his righteousness was enough. For Job, he had gotten distracted by his own works, that he'd forgotten God. What is it for you? Now listen to me, don't. Every head bowed, every eye closed. For some of you this morning, you may be at a place on your journey that maybe you're dealing with what they call in the church world, the big sins. Maybe you're here and you're struggling with alcoholism, drug addiction, a pornography addiction. Maybe you're here today and you're wrestling with some big visual addictions in your life, tangible things. Maybe that's what the Lord's trying to root out of your life. But let's dig in even deeper, the part that no one wants to talk about. Maybe you're here today and there's some bitterness that needs to be rooted out. There's some depression, discouragement. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, I have some anger in my life that needs to be rooted out. I believe there's some people here today that you've justified your life as being a good person and even a great, upright, above reproach individual. But the truth is, you are negative. You are vastly negative. Every thought and voice that comes out of your mouth tends to be negative. There's people here that you're dealing with gossip, drama. I don't know what it is, and I don't need to know. But I do know this, that the Lord might have you on a journey that doesn't make sense in order to root out something that needs to be dealt with. I know that's hard, Pastor. Where's the encouragement come? I'll show you that in a minute. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm going to pray over you. And I believe for most of you, the Lord's already spoke to you, because it's that thing that popped in your head. For those of you going, well, I didn't hear his voice, that thought that popped in your head that said you need to deal with this, that was his voice. Because I promise you this, that the enemy never wants you to deal with your hidden things. The enemy always wants to keep the hidden things hidden. And I believe there's individuals here today that the Lord has spoke to your heart, that there are relationships that many of you might be in. There are adulterous issues that you might be dealing with. There is sin patterns. There are attitude patterns. There are heart patterns, and the Lord wants to deal with those. So what is the one thing God might be trying to root out of your life in the midst of your current journey? Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus, that everyone here at the sound of my voice, Father, you would speak to them words of life. For those that are here today that are taking this moment serious, Lord, I pray that you would speak to them what that one thing is. Father, you've already spoken to me. I realize what you're dealing with in my heart, where this journey has brought me. And God, I know that I'm not the only one, and I know that there's individuals in this room right now that are in the midst of a season that may not make sense. So God, I pray that by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would speak to us this morning. That you would speak those things that only you know, because they're hidden in our hearts. Father, I pray you'd speak in the name of Jesus. In your name, amen. Now if you'd look at me for just a moment, we're not done, I'm not done. I told you in the beginning that my prayer is that you would gain insight and receive encouragement. And so I'm about to give you some encouragement. But what I want you to do before you walk out of those doors, nobody's looking at your notes, okay? No cheating, all right? I want you to grab that pen, and I want you to write down whatever the Lord said to you on that line. Come on, write it down. Just take a moment, write it down. Pastor, I don't know how to put it into words. Try. Just try. Jesus. When and only when the hidden things are revealed and dealt with can you experience what Job says at this part of his journey. See, at the end of Job's journey, everything changed. Yes, the story ends with he got back way more than he ever had. And that's great and that's wonderful. And that's the stuff we like to encourage ourselves with. Maybe you're here and you lost some income and you're believing, Lord, the Lord's going to triple it, multiply it 100 times, glory. And that's great. But see, before the multiplication took place, look at Job chapter 42, verse 5. It says, I heard of you by the hearing of my ear, meaning I knew about you. But only after I endured the journey, can he say this, but now my eyes have seen you. Now you may be here and go, Pastor, that doesn't make sense. What's the big difference between hearing and seeing? It's actually a play on words. It's about experiencing. See, before I knew about you, I knew what the ones that had gone before had said about you. I knew the stories of creation. I knew the stories about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob or whatever. I knew all these stories. I knew about you, but I didn't know you. And I believe every one of us in this room want to know God, right? I mean, who doesn't? Who wouldn't want to experience God in the way that he intended the relationship? But listen to your pastor this morning. You can't see that. You can't receive what Job received at the end of the journey until you stop asking why and start asking who. God, who are you in the midst of what seems like a valley? Who are you when everything's falling apart? Who are you when nothing makes sense? Who am I in your image? Who am I and what needs to be dealt with in my heart? Who am I and what needs to be changed so I can be more like you? Because today, I surrender. Not just my life to Christ, but every fear, every hurt, every doubt, every addiction, every regret, everything. I surrender it to you. Amen. How many of you wrote something down this morning? Can we pray? Why don't you stand to your feet as we close? I put in your next steps in your bulletin, and I hope you take the time to utilize that. To first of all, answer that hard question that I asked. But secondly, read Job chapter 38 through 41. Because see, that's where God starts telling Job who he is. And I think it would encourage you this week. I want to pray for you because I don't believe the Lord's done. I believe the Lord's going to continue to reveal those things. Those deep things. The tangible things. And regardless of what it is, how big or small it may seem, we still have to surrender. I don't know who this is for, but it's very specific. There's someone in this room that's going, my attitude doesn't compare to the attic. It does. My hurt does not compare to the adulterers and the liars and the thieves. It does. We've got to allow God to root those things out by us revealing them. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, I thank you for who you are. Father, I thank you that when we surrender to you, you take it. Our hurts, our habits, our hangups, our fears, our addictions, all of it, you take it when we surrender. Father, I know that there's people in this room that are on a journey today that maybe doesn't make sense. Maybe it's a journey they're about to walk into, another leg of the race. God, regardless of where we're at in the process, I pray that you would help us to see through your eyes the parts of our heart, our attitude, our actions that can be dealt with by the power of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would continue to speak to us as we continue to challenge us, continue to provoke us. God, I pray that you would speak life in everyone here, because a day will come, should we continue to pursue you, that not only will our ears have heard, but our eyes will see, and we will experience you in all your glory. Change us, Father, from the inside out. God, I speak a blessing over our church today. God, their homes, their children, their grandchildren, their jobs, their health, their finances. Lord, I pray a blessing over them today. Use us this week. God, minister to us as we go to our life groups throughout this week. God, that you would challenge us through conversation, that you would break us and heal us through conversation, and that you'd bring us back safely next week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.